If you look up Bresenham's line algorithm on Wikipedia, this is the first example you're going to find. When I first saw this, it looked a bit like magic to me. Why is there this variable d, which is updated every iteration? Clearly it's used to decide if our y-coordinate changes, but why is it 2dy minus dx? There doesn't seem to be a slope or anything in here either, so how does this work? It turns out I had to see all the steps required to arrive at this solution to really understand it. And that's what we'll do together in this video. Here we have a grid of pixels. We're going to assume that our image is stored from top to bottom, row by row, meaning our y-coordinate increases downwards. For the math people among you, this may seem backwards, so be aware of it. Let's pick a starting point and an endpoint. We'll call these x0, y0, and x1, y1. Our goal is to draw a line between these two points, kind of like this. Now before we get into code, we need to calculate some important properties of this line, such as the distance between our points on each axis. These are delta x and delta y, which we can simply calculate by subtracting x0 from x1 and y0 from y1. Then we also need the slope. If we move one pixel along our line horizontally, how much does the line move vertically? That is our slope, or m. Its value is just delta y over delta x, which makes sense because it represents how much change we get in y per change in x. In our case, the slope is roughly 0.27, so at every step on the x-axis, we move 0.27 pixels down. Note that the slope involves a division though, meaning this is not an integer, but a floating point value. This will be very important. Before we get to Bresenham's algorithm, which works only with integers, we should start at the very beginning and draw a line using floating point numbers. Let's write a simple implementation of a line drawing algorithm using this slope. I will write the code using Python, just because I think a lot of people these days are familiar with its syntax, but any language will do, of course. Let's call our function drawLine and make its parameters x0, y0, x1, and y1. Again, these are just our start and end pixel positions. First, we need to calculate our delta x and delta y. And then, we're going to calculate m. Here I made sure that delta x is not 0 to avoid a division by 0, which would crash our program. We then iterate over the number of pixels that we have horizontally, and for every iteration we place a pixel. Let's assume the putPixel function does that for us. We place each pixel at x0 plus I on the x-axis and y0 plus I times m on the y-axis. In other words, at every iteration we move one step to the right and m steps down. Visually, that would look something like this. We are simply plotting points on our line for every pixel. But remember, the y-coordinates are now floats because they include the slope. And the putPixel function can't actually place pixels at float coordinates, but only at perfect integers. The way we fix this is just by rounding the floating point values. This moves them to the nearest integer y-coordinate. And there we go, the algorithm now colors these pixels in, and our line is complete. However, you may have noticed a problem. The delta x, delta y, or m variables could be negative. Depending on their state, we have a total of 8 possible ways to draw our line. The algorithm so far assumes that the line always has a positive delta x, delta y, and m, which means we can only draw within this octant over here. To make it draw every possible line, we can adjust the algorithm a little. The first few lines are the same as before, we just calculate delta x and delta y. But then we'll figure out if the horizontal or vertical delta has a larger magnitude. We store the one that is larger into this step variable. Next, we make sure it's not zero, just like we did with delta x earlier. This is just to avoid divisions by zero. And now we can calculate how much we move on the x and y axis at each step. Remember, the step variable is either the magnitude of delta x or delta y. That means one of these two variables is going to be negative 1 or 1, and the other is going to be the slope, which is also positive or negative. Finally, we iterate over each pixel again and place them properly using our step variables. And of course we round them, as they may include the slope and be floats. So that's how we can draw any line if we're willing to use floats. Overall, it's not too difficult. But now let's go back to Bresenham's algorithm. As you can see, there doesn't seem to be a slope at all. Again, instead there's this d variable, which is recalculated at every iteration. So how does this draw a line? To figure that out, let's write an implementation for Bresenham's line algorithm from scratch, step by step. First, we're going to do pretty much the same as before. But this time we're going to keep track of our current y-coordinate, which starts at y0. Then, when we place pixels, we put them at x0 plus I and y. Right now, this just draws a horizontal line of pixels. At every iteration, we now need to decide if the y-coordinate should be incremented by 1. So here at the beginning, we could keep y the same, or we could increment it by 1. Clearly, the line goes through the top pixel, so let's pick that one. This next iteration, we'd decide again. Does y remain the same, or become y plus 1? Well, I'd say the line is a little bit more inside the bottom pixel, so let's color that one in. The question we now need to answer is, how can we make these decisions using math? The answer is surprisingly simple. Let's mark the pixel coordinates of our possible y-coordinates as 2 points. These are y and y plus 1. Then we place another point perfectly on our line. I'm going to call this one py. If we take the distance between each point and py, we get two distances, d0 and d1. In this particular step, d1 is slightly smaller than d0. That means we're going to decide to increment y to y plus 1. Alright, let's adapt our code to make these decisions. How do we calculate py? Well, py is just the amount of pixels we move to the right times the slope. That's because we move down by the slope at every step on the x-axis. Just like we did earlier in the float example. Now that we have py, we can calculate d0 and d1. And by checking the difference between these distances, we know whether to increment our y-coordinate or not. Cool, so this algorithm once again works and draws our line perfectly. But wait a second. I said we can't use the slope because Bresenham's line algorithm only uses integers. How do we get rid of the slope from our calculations? Well, that's where the fun part begins. Currently, we decide whether to increment y based on d0 minus d1. We call this variable the decision parameter, so let's just define it as p. To make changes to p, we first need to rearrange some stuff. Let's start by replacing d0 and d1 over here with the expressions we use to calculate them. And then there's still py in there, so let's replace that with its expression as well. We get this beautiful mess of an expression. Next, we can simplify this a little bit by getting rid of the parentheses. First, we'll get rid of these, and then of these. If you pay close attention to the terms in our expression, you'll also notice something. We have a bunch of pairs. For example, there's 2 times y0 and 2 times negative y, and so on. To be exact, here are the duplicate terms we have. We can rewrite them by multiplying each duplicated term with 2. Putting them back together gives us an even cleaner expression. Our goal is to get rid of our floating point number, which is m. So let's replace m by its value, which is delta y over delta x. To get rid of our float, we need to get rid of this division. How can we get rid of a division by delta x? By multiplying each term with delta x. So let's do that. Now there's something to note here. If this was an equation, we'd also have to multiply the other side by delta x, so our p is now actually p times delta x. However, in our code here, we will ignore that. For our decision parameter, this multiplication has no impact on the result. It just scales the difference between d0 and d1, which is irrelevant to our decision. Just wanted to make sure to point that out. Moving on, now that our float is gone from the expression, we can simplify some more. We can multiply the terms in the remaining parentheses by 2 times delta y to get rid of them. And that's pretty much it for our decision parameter. But it's still a bit complex. To simplify it even more, let's figure out our initial value of p, as well as the formulas necessary to update it at every iteration. Let's first set our initial p value equal to the decision parameter p. Now think about this for a second. What is our I and our y on the very first iteration of the function? Well, I starts at 0, and y is set equal to y0. So let's replace I with 0 and y with y naught. Now the first term is multiplied by 0, so it just goes away. We are also adding and subtracting 2 times y naught times delta x, so these cancel each other out and also go away. All we're left with is 2 times delta y minus delta x. And that's the initial value of p at the first iteration. I'm just going to comment it out for now, we're going to get back to it later. All that's left is to find out how much we need to increment the value of p at every step. So let's go back to our expression up here. There are some terms in here that will never change. After all, delta x, delta y, and y naught never change throughout the entire function. For our purposes, that is very interesting because they won't affect our change in p. So we can just get rid of them. Now let me rearrange the y and delta x here to make things prettier. If this is the expression used to calculate our current p-value, how do we calculate the next pixel's p-value? Well, first we take the same expression. Then we increment I by 1, which refers to the next x-coordinate. But what is the next pixel's y-value? We don't know yet, so we can't fill it in. Depending on whether the current step will move on the y-axis or not, y could either stay the same or go to y plus 1. So which is it? For now, let's use a variable as a placeholder and call it yNext. It represents whichever the next value of y is. Now that we know p and pNext, we can calculate the step required to go from p to pNext. That is, the difference between them. And as always, we can expand these variables into their actual expressions. If we rearrange this a little, we can see the first two terms are multiplied by 2 times delta y, and the last two terms are multiplied by 2 times delta x. Once again, we can use this to simplify our expression. Finally, we are ready to calculate our new p-values. But remember, there are two scenarios here. In one, the y-coordinate has changed. In the other, it has remained unchanged. So let's define two variables. P if y was increased, and p if y is unchanged. Both of these will be equal to the previous p-value plus our p-step. But what makes them different is that each has a different value for y next. So let's fill that into our expressions. Then we just keep on simplifying. I and minus I just cancel each other out. And then we can just get rid of that 1 because anything multiplied by 1 remains the same. Y and minus y cancel each other out as well, leaving us with a 1 and a 0 in each expression. After multiplying all this out, we can't simplify anymore, which means we're almost done. First, we move the initial p-value outside the loop. Then we move our p-calculation if y increased into the if statement below. And finally, we move the p-calculation if y remains unchanged into the else case. If we want to simplify one last thing, we could get rid of the else case. As both p-calculations contain the term p plus 2 times delta y, we can simply do that on every iteration and remove it from the p-calculation inside the if statement. It took a bunch of steps, but now we have fully reproduced the code sample you saw in the beginning of the video. See, they call it capital D, but that's our decision parameter P right here. This algorithm now draws a line in a pixel grid using nothing but integers. And hopefully you were able to follow along and understand all the steps we took. But there's one more problem. As with the float version, this algorithm only covers a single octant. There are 7 more octants in which the algorithm does not work. Once again, we are assuming that delta x, delta y, and therefore m are all positive. So let's go back to the algorithm and modify it to cover all possible octants. First, let's figure out if our line is moving up rather than down. If delta y is positive, we'll store a 1, and if it's negative, we'll store a negative 1. Then we multiply delta y by this direction, and use the direction to increase or decrease our y on every iteration. Now our line can be drawn if dx is positive and dy is negative, which basically means we have a negative slope. Next, we want to cover the octants with a negative delta x. Let's check if x0 is greater than x1. If so, we will swap our start and endpoint. So rather than solving the problem, we just flip our line to change which octant we're dealing with. Now we can draw every possible horizontal line, so let's rename this function to drawLineH. To make a vertical version, we can simply duplicate the function. Let's take every occurrence of delta x and delta y and swap them, and then also replace our y and y naught with x and x naught. And that's all there is to it. This function now draws vertical lines, meaning we have covered all 8 octants. All that's left is to decide which of these two functions we use to draw our line. The actual drawLine function will check if our magnitude of delta x or delta y is larger to determine whether the line is horizontal or vertical. Depending on the result, we call drawLineH or drawLineV. And that's it. Now we have a fully working implementation of Bresenham's line algorithm. We could try to further optimize the algorithm or clean things up, but we've covered how the algorithm works in detail, so let's leave it at that and end this video. I hope you learned something, and thank you for watching.